all I have here. This is larger sizes, size 14 scud hook, and I've just got a Cyclops bead on it, just a brass bead. That's in black nickel. It's 3/32. I like to step down a size sometimes on these. I want to keep the bodies really thin. And we're just going to start our thread right behind the bead, take a few wraps, and then I've got some brassy size silver wire. When you get down in the smaller sizes, that's when you want to step down the size of the wire down to a small or something like that. And then for the really, really small ones, down to into the low 20s, or high 20s, I guess I should say, then you can even get away with the extra small, but I usually don't bother. I'm going to take a small length of this wire, and you just pull it off, and you don't want to let go. If you let go, it's going to all spin up, and that's no good there. So then you just wrap it around back on top, and then should be able to just break off for you. Then we're going to take the tip of this wire, and I like to just put it up under the bead a little bit, and then catch it in with a few wraps, and then take this wire and your thread all the way down the shank of the hook. It should be a fairly long body. You want to go deep into the bend of the hook, so right about there, just leaving you enough just to hook the fish. I mean, that's pretty much all you need there. Then we're going to wrap back up, cover up any of those bald spots that you missed, and take it all the way up to the front of the bead, and then we're going to work back down. And stop probably about 1/8 of an inch from the last point where you tied in thread. We'll work back up. And we're going to keep on repeating this process until we build up a nice, thin, slender body. We want to have fairly good taper to it. Once we get nice taper built up, then I like to take wraps all the way back down. You can take a couple extra where you've got little bits of steps and stuff like that. You want to fill in all the spots, make sure you have a nice smooth body. And back up the thread, or at the bead there, and I do like to leave the bead just a little bit bigger than our thread body, so that way we have a little bit of wiggle room to tie off our wire. The wire, I like to take one full wrap at the back, and then we can start palmering it with open spiral wraps all the way up to the front. Once we get up to the front, take our thread, cross the wire, and pull it straight out. Take a few more, just make sure it's locked down tight, and then pull your wire back. And take a few more in front, and instead of using your expensive tying scissors to cut this wire and dull our scissors out, what we're going to do is helicopter it off, and it should break off nice and close. Then I like to push in any little bits of tag that's left so we don't fray up our thread and end up losing the fly at the very last moment. Then we're going to take a few more wraps to clean up, then take our whip finish tool. Front hook first, wrap it around the notch, make sure we get our figure four, and then just a few wraps here, 3-4 turns, then point it up, so we're just on that front hook, pull down with our bobbin, and let our thread out. I'm just going to take my scissors here, get them real close, and pull that off. And then you're essentially done. These flies are easy to tie. You can tie out dozens in no time flat, so not a big deal, but if you want to, just take a little bit of super glue here, and I've got the brush applicator on the super glue. You can use super glue, head cement, whatever you need. I like to just take just a little bit, touch the top, and I also like to go back here and touch the back of those wraps there, just make sure we don't lose any. Alright, and that is Zebra Midge, no problem. Set that to the side there. Next one is going to be personally one of my favorite patterns. I really like patterns with copper bodies. I don't know why, but something about them just catches your eye. We're going to take our hook there. That's a size 14, I believe. Scud hook. Now I'm going to ditch our black thread there. And then I'm going to get whatever I ended up putting it. Some olive 8-aught thread. And this is particularly olive dun. I really like the olive dun to match up some of the peacock that we're going to put on the head of this fly. This one's called the Brassie. It doesn't really look like it's brass, but I don't know why it's called that, but I'm sure there's a story behind it. So we're just going to stick our thread down in there. Then if you got one of those tools that you can thread it through, that's easy. But particularly with ceramic bobbins and some of the other ones, you can end up scarring up the inside and you'll end up with frayed thread all the time. So what I like to do is just start it in our bobbin just at the very back end and then suck it through with your mouth there. And all we're going to do is take our thread, start it right up at the eye there, then bring it back about a quarter of the space that you're going to be tying in, and bring it back to the front. I'm just going to break off our thread there. Then on these larger size brassies, I like to step up to medium copper. And you can definitely stick with the actually brassy sized copper wire, and that's where the BR comes from. But medium is bigger than brassy, and I like it for these bigger sizes because it gives a little bit more segmentation, a little bit thicker body. Then we're just going to take that wire, tie it in right on the side, and then stop there. And this is one of my biggest tricks for getting smooth copper underbody, or smooth underbody under wire, and that's don't tie it in all the way down to where you want to stop. Some people say it's not as secure, but the way that I'm going to tie this in, it's pretty tough, and you get a fish that breaks it off, you're good. Talking big fish, so it's definitely worth losing a fly or two to get a smoother, better looking body, I think. So this is another trick you can use on that zebra midge that we just tied. Just tie in the front portion and then wrap it down to where you need. It works really great on those smaller sizes, but bigger sizes, I like to tie it in all the way to the back. Alright, so now that we've got our wire catched in up there, it's going to take another shot of super glue. And you really don't want to get too much on this. You want to really make sure you wipe off that brush. And just a thin amount. I like to just put it on the back, just down to where we need to put our wire, right at where that bend on the hook really starts to go. We're going to just take this, wrap it around, and touching turns, all the way down to the end of the hook. And a nice trick for when you're wrapping touching wires like this is pull back a little bit. The wire itself will push the wire that you're wrapping in right next to each other. And if you get one that, say you pull a little bit too far forward and you start going up around like that, it's easy to fix. Just back off and then go back to wrapping it again. Because if you get a little gap in there, it's really hard to fix afterwards, and it just doesn't look good. Alright, so we're down at the end where I want to stop tying. I just pull this tight, and then helicopter it off just like we did before on the zebra midge. And pops right off, and you got a smooth, clean body. Alright, and then next step, we're going to take some peacock curl. Getting good quality peacock curl is really essential. You get some of the scraggly old stuff that's brittle, it'll always break on you, and it doesn't have quite as many fibers. And all I do is break off the first couple inches or so of the hurl. The reason why you do that is because this end here is really flimsy and you don't want to deal with that. So we've got two hurls here. Then just take out the first couple inches, hold it tight, then break it off. There you go. I'm going to tie this in right on the top. Bring it back, right back to where our copper body starts. Bring this forward to the eye. I take this, make sure you got everything lined up the way that you want it. Just gonna wrap touching turns all the way back. If you can do this in one shot without having to go back over itself, you end up with a really nice full body. Once we get up to the front here, I'm just gonna take my thread, take it under, wrap it up over there, and pull this straight out. Take one, two, three more wraps. Before I break all this off, I'm gonna pull everything back, everything front of the eye, I'm gonna pull back. Make sure we have no trapped fibers or anything like that. Take a few more, and I do like to build up a nice small head on here. Once we got that little head built up, take our whip finish tool, front hook first, back in the notch, make your figure four, and two, three wraps up, pull your bobbin, hook out. Alright, and then take our thread away, take these tag ends, trim them out, there you've got your Brassie. This is another great Midge pattern. Works fairly well as an attractor, but that big heavy lead body there really helps get deep in the water without having to have a bead. Alright, next one is going to be the Adams. And the Adams is not the easiest tie to fly, or fly to tie. So I'm just going to show you a simple version. Doesn't have quite all the bells and whistles that the standard Adams has, but it really does get the job done. Fish don't seem to mind, so I don't really mind. I'm going to ditch that olive thread. Get ourselves some gray thread. And if you're just starting out, I really do recommend this uni thread. A little bit easier to work with, especially if you're backwards tire like I am, than the UTC or the Danville. Really stays together nice. You don't end up with bits of thread splitting out everywhere. Alright, and then I'm just going to start right at the first third mark there. Wrap this back all the way back to about halfway between the point of the hook and the barb of the hook. Break our thread out. One more wrap just to clean up. And then for tailing material, what I've got here is just cheap cock hackle neck. And that's just plain brown. It's got a little bit of the badger in there, but just real cheap. I guess it's a saddle that I picked up. I got it for dirt cheap. All the sizes are about a 10, so not really good for much else, and it's a little bit sparser than the good whiting stuff, so I really like to use it for tailing materials. And all I do is strip out these lower webby fibers, then we're left with the stiff stuff up front. And take out maybe close to a dozen or so of those. Pull it out straight and hold it with this finger. And then peel them off, make sure all the tips stay aligned. We got great tailing material there. So all I do is measure out, I like it about the length of the shank of the hook. Not the whole hook, but just the shank. Transfer that, so we're left with just little bits of butts there. Then wrap that forward, capturing all those. Up with a nice tail.
Hey, knock it off.
Then just like to smooth out all that body that we got there. And take some Adam's Gray fine and dry. And take out just a little bit. I mean, just a tiny bit. That's all you need to start out with. Biggest problem with dry flies in particular is that they get overdubbed. And you end up with a big fat body that's not tapered at all. See, that's about as thin as I like these dubbing noodles. Get any thicker and you just lose quite a bit of control. You can always go back over and add more, but it's really hard to go back and take off more. You're just going to build up a little bit. We do get a little bit thicker towards the far end there, just to build up our taper. We're going to take this, bring our dubbing all the way back to where we tied in those tails, and then bring it forward, building up a slight taper as we go. Like I said, you can always go back over, add a little bit more. Really hard to take off less. So we got a nice little taper body there. Might add in just a little bit more. This is size of the body is more dependent on the bugs that you have rather than, you know, tying techniques. It's more what you're trying to imitate. Alright, and then pull all these back. Pull all the dubbing fibers back. And then take your thread wrap in front. That's going to help keep the body a little bit tighter. And then I take hackle. This is a saddle hackle from Whiting. See, it's nice and long. You can get tons of flies out of these. And then I'm just going to strip off some of the bottom fibers, just so we got something to tie into. And it's always good to double check if you either got hackle gauge or if you have a, if you don't have one, you can always use the hook there just to make sure that you're getting the right size. So I'll show you here, looking just past the point of the hook there. That's where you want your hackle to go. I'm going to strip off some of these fibers up here since it's a little bit smaller at the back. Trim that out. I want this, each hackle has a shiny side and a dull side there. So I always like to have the shiny side pointing towards me. If you can't really tell which one's the shiny side and which one's the dull side is the one that's facing towards the skin, and the shiny side's the one that's facing towards you. Alright, so we just tie in just the very stem of that hackle. Then we've got all the fibers out here, stroking clean. And then there's kind of what I figured out, there's two schools of thought on which way to wrap it in. The way that keeps the eye nice and clean and clear for you to tie is shiny side facing forward, and the way that I generally like to tie it is dull side forward. That way when you tie in a small head, it really builds up all the fibers and gets you really dense amount of hackle there. So we're just wrapping this, touching turns, make sure you don't trap too many of the other hackle fibers as you're going. Just going to move my thread forward a little bit. Wrap this forward. Keep on going till you get to the eye. When you think that you can't fit anymore, do maybe one more wrap. Alright, so we're right at the eye. Pull this up. Take my thread. Cross that hackle once. Come down. Pull everything back. Get one, two on there, and one more on the stem of that hackle. Pull back, one, two, three, and then we're going to whip finish. It's always a good idea, especially on dry flies, pull all those fibers back while you're whip finishing. You don't want to catch too many in that head. Pull tight. Trim out our thread. Pull this forward. And then trim out our stem. And give these a nice little fluff. Alright, that's a real, real simple Adams. The normal Adams, you'll add in grizzly hackle fibers towards the back, grizzly hackle in the front, and then you also add grizzly hackle wings. But this way, you can get away with buying one type of hackle. Alright, next one is going to be the Hares ear. That's fairly simple nymph fly. Even a little bit simpler than the pheasant tail, I think. A little bit less technical to tie. So, great one to start out with. We're going to ditch that gray thread. On here, I've got a 1/8 gold bead. This is a size 10 hook. On bigger nymphs, you can get away stepping up a little bit. So, first thing that we're going to do is get our thread started here. This is camel. Camel is a great color for pheasant tails and hare's ears. Quite a few nymphs, actually. Great brown color. Take our thread. Got a little bit of fuzzies on the end there, so I'm going to trip off just a bit there. Pull out enough to work with. Get that started. Alright, so we got our thread started in there. And then you can add some weight behind this, so go ahead and do that. You just got some lead wire, lead free wire, whichever you choose. This is 0.020. And all you're going to do is hold this. I like to hold it between my middle finger and my thumb. And that way you've got a little bit. You can pinch it with your thumb and middle finger, give yourself a little bit more tension. And you're just going to work that just like you would a bobbin. About 6 or 7 wraps back there. Break that off. Then I like to take everything, compress it down, pull this the bead and the lead wire back. Take some super glue. This helps everything keep from spinning and keeps everything tight to the front of the hook. Just a little bit on the front there. And slide this all forward, making sure that wire is seated up really tight in that bead. We're going to take this forward, break it off, just like we do the thread. The lead's soft enough, you can get away with doing that. Then, and take our thread, I like to start right behind that wire there. Build up a couple turns, then wrap into that wire. Want to make sure everything's seated down, because if this gets spinning, then the whole fly is going to come unraveled. So, good idea to make sure that's locked down and help cover up that lead a little bit. We'll work our way back down to the end of the hook. Again, using that same marker that we did on the Adams, I'll make sure that we're about halfway between the barb and the point of the hook there. And then for the tail, you're going to take, if I can find them, take a hare's mask. I got a couple pieces of hair in here. Take a hare's mask. And then on the hare's mask, I would like to take the tailing material from either up in this section, right below the ears, right in that section there, or right above essentially the bridge of the nose right there. So then all you're going to do is take a small clump, and pull it up tight, about 90 degrees to the skin there. take your scissors, go in real close to the skin if you can. And it'll get easier with more practice, and the more that you cut off, you'll get a little bit more room to work on there. We're just going to wind up with just a little bit of a tail there. So I'm going to grab that with our front fingers and clear out all the fluff and extra small hairs on there. And if you have any extra long guard hairs or anything like that, you can pull those out. That's going to be our tail right there. You want to keep it real short, maybe about the length of the thorax, or length of the bead and the thorax. I like them really short, but fairly thick. I'll tie that in. So we got our tail there. Just going to take touching wraps all the way back up to where we tied in that lead. And once you get there, take all these waist ends and trim them out with your scissors. All right, and doing that just helps keep our underbody level and keep everything tight. Alright, now I'm just going to clean up a little bit, help build up a little bit of a taper. Next material that we're going to tie in is some French tinsel. This is small size. You can go up a little bit, go down a little bit, but small seems to get the job done on most flies. Take out a little bit of that. Cut it off. And normally on the larger sizes, you can pull off the outside a little bit, outside braid a little bit, expose the inner fibers and tie that in, but the smaller stuff doesn't really like to cooperate with that. Just gonna tie that in down the side of the hook. Alright, and then pull that back out of the way. And take some Hares mask dubbing, and this is some homemade stuff. I'm sure you can find some other stuff in your local shop or online that's already pre-made for you, but I really like to make it at home myself. You can make it as spiky or as thin and flat as you want. That really gives you a little bit more control over your dubbing that way. Just gonna dub on a little bit. You can use some wax and wax your thread a little bit if you want to, but I like to keep the thread bare that way, make it a little bit more buggy, a little bit more spiky, and more efficient, the more buggy it's going to get, so not too bad of a deal there. Just going to dub this on fairly thick, a lot thicker than we did the dry fly. You can see it there, pretty thick. Take that, take our dubbing all the way back to where we tied in the tails. Just going to build up a body here. You always want to tighten a little bit, right up to just behind where we tied in those tail, or that lead wire there. Build up a little bit of a tapered body there. Pull out any fibers that are loose, not going to stick around for you. And just a little bit more at the front there. Back and clean up. Alright, now we're going to take our French tinsel, open spiral wraps to the front, and you normally get in about 3, maybe 4 wraps in. And tie that down. And trim it off real close. Alright, then next material, take some pheasant tail, strip off. I like to have them really thick, so about a dozen or so fibers. And a lot of people tie this in with the tips first, but on wing cases that are just going to be wing cases, they're not going to be legs also or anything like that. Take the butt ends, trim off all the fuzzies, and then I like to start tying them in at the very front. That way we can go in with our nail and flatten everything out so we get nice broad wing case. Alright, so we got a spot for our thorax there. And take that same Hares ear dubbing, dub it onto the thread. This time we want to be fairly thick with it. This is the part that we really want to be dubbed nice and buggy. Alright, so start wrapping. And go back and forth a few times. We really want to build up this thorax. Alright, so I'm going to take that dubbing all the way up to the back behind the bead, and then I like to work my way back, and once you get the bare thread, get really open spiral wraps to the front, maybe two wraps over the whole course of the thorax. I'm going to take our fingers, I'm going to make a small triangle there, if I can get the camera focus, small triangle with your fingers, pull everything back out of the way. Start your thread right there, then we're gonna preen everything down. You moisten your fingers a little bit, preen everything down, and take this pheasant tail wing case and take that forward. I like to make sure everything's in line first. Make sure everything's staying out of the way of that bead. Take one wrap right over the top, cinch it down fairly tight, take maybe two more, and pull everything back, take a few in the front, one or two more over the top, one front. Before we touch anything else, I'm going to go ahead and whip finish, front hook first, back in the notch, figure four, get a few good wraps in there, and tighten up. Trim out our thread, pull all these up tight, coming underneath as flat as you can, cut those out. Alright, and see, we got a nice big wing case there, nice buggy body, and preen everything down out of the way, and then you can touch the thread in the top with a little bit of super glue, head cement, or another good way, especially if you get into problems with this wing case breaking off with, you know, fish teeth or anything like that, just take a little bit of UV goo, take that on the top, build up a pretty big bead. Just gonna bring a little bit over the top of the bead like that, make sure you have a nice shape all the way back to the end of the wing case, hit that with a light. This is great fly. There's tons of variations that you can do with it. You know, the Guide's Choice is another great fly. It's one of my favorites. You can add a flashback over the top. You can add pheasant tail legs, whatever you want to do with that. But great fly all around. All right, and the last one that we're going to do here is a woolly bugger. And the woolly bugger is probably the fly that's caught the most fish over in anywhere in the world. You know, any species, just about any species. Just matters the size that you tie it and the colors that you tie. Alright, so we're going to ditch that brown thread. Got some olive thread here. We're going to do a olive woolly bugger. And this is no bead on this one. We're going to take our wire here, our lead wire, same as before. We're just going to wrap 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 wraps. Break it off, and you can adjust the size of the wire that you want to use, the amount of wraps that you do, everything. You can even do no weight on these. Really hard to mess up with a woolly bugger. You can do just about anything and they'll still catch fish. So about 15 wraps of wire. You can do more or less, like I said. You can add a bead, tungsten bead, double bead, whatever you want to do. However you want to fish it, how deep you want to go. Just going to bring that up to the front, making sure that we leave enough room here so we can tie in all our materials and build up a nice head. So maybe about 1/8 of an inch or so. Take our thread here. Didn't put it through the bobbin yet. And olive is great pattern or great color, especially for still waters. It's a great damselfly imitation. Depends on the size that you tie it. You can tie them fairly big and, you know, more of a bait fish pattern, or tie them small. This one here is a size 10, which is pretty much my standard size. Size 12 is generally about the smallest that I'll tie it. You can definitely go smaller than that, but size 10 is pretty good all around size. Alright, and we're just gonna start up just right in front of this lead. Make sure that we leave plenty of room on that eye. So I'm not gonna start right up behind the eye, I'm gonna start right back here. We're gonna go big open pattern, open spirals over that lead. Tie it down tight at the back, and we're going to work on covering up that lead. Alright, and then I can take this thread all the way back to the back, just like before, halfway between the point of the hook and the barb of the hook. Alright, and then we've got some olive marabou. And marabou is probably the biggest spot that I see people mess up woolly buggers. That and the hackle, but we'll get to the hackle. But the best way to tie it in, not necessarily the quickest or easiest way to tie it in, but definitely the best looking way and best fishing way, is we're just going to take our marabou plume, strip off all any of that's discolored or anything like that, and then take one side of it, grab all the ends in our finger just like that, and strip it off from the stem. We're going to take where the butt ends are, we're going to put that right where that lead starts. Take 1, 2 wraps on that. Now, depending on the quality of the marabou and how big your stem is, you may need to take a couple plumes out, but really depends on how thick you want this tail or how thin you want it. Same as before. 1, 2. And take that thread up right behind the lid. I'm just going to catch this down. But we get that other plume ready. Take that down, all the way back down to where we tied everything in before. Take one more plume of marabou here. tie that in just like the others. Alright, now I'm going to take all these scragglers here and trim those out. Then I'm just going to clean up this section here. We're going to thread all the way back to where we ended there. Alright, so now we've got pretty long tail here. So what we're going to do is bring this out about the length of the hook, maybe about the length of the shank of the hook. I'm going to take our other hand, pinch these real tight back here, and break it off. If you run into problems, you can't break it all off. Just fan it out a little bit, just like that. You can see in the corner of the screen there. And break it off pieces at a time. It's better than cutting, because cutting you end up with a really clean straight edge and it just doesn't look right. So if you break it, you end up with frayed ends like that. So we've got our tail there. And if you tie it in with the stem coming out, it's not going to have quite as much wiggle as it could. Not going to fish quite as good as it does like this. So that's, in my opinion, by far the best method to do. Alright, so now we've got our tail tied in. It's got two strands of crystal flash, and this is a chartreuse crystal flash here. Take that in. Not going to pay attention to too much to where it's at, how long it is or anything like that. Yeah. Take that in, pinch it down on the side of the hook. Take a couple wraps. Might get wrapped up on your bobbin, that's fine. Just bring it out of the way. Alright, I'm going to bring it back just about an eighth of an inch or so, not too far, maybe a quarter of an inch. And then, instead of cutting it off right there, what we're going to do is wrap it over the top of the hook and bring it over. Bring it over on the far side. Try to get in the middle of the hook there. And tie it down. That way it's going to have a lot less of a chance of pulling out, and be a little bit more solid, a little bit more durable for you. Then what we're going to do is preen these back. I know you can't really see, but I cut those off just a little bit past the end of the marabou there. Alright. Then, next step, we're going to take some more wire. This is kind of a copper brown color. You can use normal copper. You can use green if you want to, any color that you want. And I'm just going to take out a bit here. And a good trick, if you ever get to the point where it's caught underneath and you can't quite get it with your fingers, just figure out where it is. Take the hook end of your whip finish tool, poke it under there, and it'll bring it right out for you. I don't like to use tips of scissors or anything like that, or not usually bodkins, because I've broken a bodkin on it before, but you don't want to dull your scissors out, you don't want to mess up a bodkin, but the whip finish tool seems to be fairly durable. It hasn't broken on me yet, so no problem there. We're just going to take about the length of the body there and wrap it down and back up. And you can't tie this in more than enough. You can always take more, but if you take less, then chances are your wire is going to pull out and it's not going to serve its purpose anymore. So let's wrap this down really tight. You want to make sure you get plenty of wraps on it. Not a bad thing to over wrap this wire. Alright, and now the next step would be to add chenille, but personally I've never found a chenille that I'm happy with wrapping on a woolly bugger, so all I do is take some dubbing, and this is some life cycle Cadis dubbing, and this is I believe it's Wopsie who makes this. It might be Hairline, I'm not quite sure, but this is great dubbing. This particular box I've used just about every color. Great dubbing. It's always served its purpose, and don't have a color in it right now that I don't like. Alright, so we're just going to take out a clump and want this to be fairly thick body, so don't be afraid to dub. And personally, I like either a carrot shape with the fat end up front or perfectly level. Depends on personal preference, but that's the way that I like it. So here we're going to do a flat body. To do a flat body, it's really simple. Just make sure that the dubbing noodle that you're building up is flat. It doesn't have any taper to it. It doesn't have any big bulging spots. And the way that you do that is a big problem that I see with a lot of beginning tyers, either watching them on YouTube or teaching them here, is that this dubbing, you don't want to take a big fat clump out and try to dub it off that. You want to take just a little bit. You know, that's all that I'll dub on thread at a time. If I'm going really, really thick, maybe I'll dub that on at a time. But really, really light, because if you get too much dubbing on there at once, it's going to form a big dog leg and you're going to have tight wrap dubbing around your thread, and that's not good. Alright, so what I'm going to do here is bring that dubbing right back to the tail. Wrap that forward. If you don't have a wrap of dubbing that you don't like, try to go back, try to fix it. Better to fix it as soon as you see it rather than later, because awful hard to get dubbing off if you do a good job. Alright, just a little bit more here. Alright, just building up a little bit of dubbing just in that front spot where there wasn't lead. Alright, and then like we did on the atoms, I'm going to pull all those dubbing fibers back, take a couple tight wraps right in front, and then now I'm going to bring this thread all the way down to the eye of the hook. Alright, and then here we've got our hackle. This is a whiting bugger pack, and these are great, great hackles in my opinion. A lot of movement in the water, and they're nice and stiff, so instead of kind of flowing with water, they kind of wiggle. Alright, so we've got our feather here, and then we're going to strip off some of these lower fibers. I like to get pretty much all of them out. If you leave a little bit of tag, that's also good. Gives you a little bit of something to grab onto. And we're going to take this hackle right where the fibers start. That's where we're going to start on the body. You can leave as much bare stem as you want hanging out past the body, but want those fibers to start right where the body's touching the bare hook. Take a few wraps. I like to have this fairly tight in there. And these are stiff stems, so sometimes you do get them to break on you, but that's fine. You just got to go back and get another feather. And like you saw me do there, I like to double this over onto the head of the fly, because that gives you a little bit more durability and definitely a more even head. Just going to trim out the back end of the stem there. Then we're going to take our feather, bring it underneath and around. And see how the hackle is pointing backwards. We want that shiny side, like I was talking about before, we want the shiny side of the feather pointing towards the eye. So if you get it the other way, it doesn't look quite right, doesn't fish quite right. So we're just going to take open spiral wraps all the way to the back. I like quite a bit of hackle on my woolly bugger, so we're going to bring it right to the very end, right to where we tied in that wire. And take our wire and then cross the hackle stem. And then it's kind of like, the way I think about it is you're continuing this wrap. So we're going to counter wrap this going forward, but we're essentially turning the same way going forward. So we're going to catch that in. And then if you just kind of zigzag your wire and move it forward, we want to keep even spacing on this wire, but we also don't want to catch too many of these hackle fibers. So if you kind of zigzag like this with your wire, it helps keep the amount of fibers that you trap down. It also lets you keep that wire spaced evenly. There's counter wrapping here. And this counter wrapping, compared to wrapping it the normal way, catches more fibers, more hackle fibers definitely, but it builds much stronger fly, because if you get fish tooth come in here and break that hackle stem, your fly is done. But with this wire counter wrapped like this, at least you got something to save there. It's going to hold down the rest of the hackle fibers. You might have one piece that's broken, but you can just trim that out or break it off. But if you don't have that, the whole fly is done. So I'm just bringing up my wire there and catch it in. Same as before with the hackle stem to try to keep this head even. I'm going to wrap that around to the other side and wrap that down. Alright, and then let's helicopter this wire off, breaks off. Brush all these fibers back there. And then take our whip finish tool. Hook first, then notch in figure four. 1, 2, 3, 4 wraps. That's plenty. There we go. Trim out our thread. We still got this tag back here of all the leftover hackle, so we're going to reach in, try not to cut off too many hackle fibers in the process, but just trim out just the stem of that. And on this fly in particular, it's really important that we hit that thread head with some varnish, super glue, anything that you got there, just to make sure that it sits just the way that you want it. Make sure that it lasts as long as possible. So I'm just going to hit that all the way around. Alright, and that's an olive woolly bugger. And like I said, it's a great damselfly pattern. Great for dragonfly nymphs too. Bait fish, anything like that. I don't know what it imitates, but it does a good job of it. Alright, and that's just a few patterns there to get you started that definitely will catch fish for you. They've caught fish for me, so hope you learned something. Hope you enjoyed that, and let me know if you got any questions below. Thank you.